Okay. It's still on page Kuf Lamed Aleph. Excuse me. We will start on the line that begins with what she-al-yedayzeh, which is five lines from the bottom. Right now we're talking about essentially to understand the difference between oir and shefa. And we started from shefa. Shefa means that something of substance is being transmitted from one to the other. When we talk about the motion of water flow coming from a reservoir, and then we came to what koyach hazrika. Koyach hazrika, this is a koyach in the hand of a person. And he is expanding this koyach in throwing a rock. When he expands this koyach to throw the rock, he actually gives out a koyach from his hand, which embraces the rock. The way the Rebbe expresses it is in the line before the one we're starting, that the koyach actually separates from the essence of the hand, and it embraces the rock, and it carries the rock as a result, because this koyach has been now expanded from the hand, and the rock being embraced by this koyach, it flows together with this koyach.
Is this five lines from the end of the page?
Seven.
Thanks.
Seven lines.
Two, four, six, seven,
five. Six lines. Six lines from the bottom.
Line starting hen?
She-al-yedayzeh.
Seven, okay.
Seven.
Seven lines. Because the koyach is able to surround the rock from all sides, and as we pointed out, the Rebbe makes an effort, makes a point, that it surrounds the rock not only from the bottom to carry it up, but it actually embraces it from all sides. Mikolzat. And this is how it is able to carry it upwards. Ukshakola ha-koyach, when this koyach ends, because initially this koyach was a limited koyach that was given off, harihunayful nabat, then automatically the rock will fall down, because there's nothing to hold it up. We discussed this quite extensively, this whole phenomenon, particularly due to the fact that this is completely contrary to the principles of the way things are explained, so to speak, in the natural world. And as a result of that, we came to realize that the Rebbe actually sees things completely differently than we see it in the natural world. In the natural world, we see there was a world and things can happen in the world on the basis of the worldly principles. This is not the way the Rebbe sees it. There are no worldly principles. There's only the Creator, the divine principles. And the world is only representative of that principle. Now, they pointed out, and just very briefly, very important to realize, physically the rock flies because it was thrown. And when it doesn't fly, it doesn't fly, it falls down to the ground. There is no principle involved that the rock should not be flying. Whereas when you talk from a divine perspective, the way the Rebbe created the world, the rock flying is something which is contrary to the plan of the way the Rebbe should want in the world. Therefore, if it is flying, they have to constantly counter the principle of what the world stands for and carry the rock off. Okay, now towards the end of this line. The koyach zeh, but this koyach that actually carries this rock, who bivchinas hislapshus. It is in the manner of hislapshus. The word hislapshus means like a garment. That it embraces, it dresses itself into this koyach to have it to make it act. It is not something that is happening superficially. Islapshus is similar. If you want to sit down and learn something, you cannot learn something by looking at it. You can't even learn something by reading the words. You really actually have to focus in and be mislavish in what's being taught, not even in the words, but to what is intended by these words. You have to get into the mind of the writer. What is he trying to tell you? Listen to these slapshots. And this is the motion for shefa, that the rock, in order for the rock to be lifted off the ground and fly, you have to be mislavish in this union of making the rock fly. And the Rebbe explains it more in detail. That the union of Islapshus is Heim, the Islapshus is true. Heim mitzad hazoirik, both from the perspective of the thrower, that the thrower is involved fully in this throw. The heim mitzad hadover hanizak, and similarly also from the perspective of the object that is being thrown. And he explains this, the principle of hislapshus. How do we identify the hislapshus in these two aspects? The harei, for behold, hazoreg nitzvas behazrika. The thrower is grasped, means that he is at this point identified with this action of zrika. Bezesh shetzorech lizrik. In the very fact that tzorich lizrik, that he has to distract himself from anything else that he is doing, and he has to focus in and decide that he has to throw. This identifies him with this throw. Why does he need to identify with this tree? Sheloitiyeh hazrikom meyatzmo. Because his riko is not going to come meyatzmo in and of itself. Even though the person has a koyach hazeik, he has a koyach to throw, but this koyach is not going to act on its own without the person activating it intentionally. Which means that he is now identifying this koyach hazirika and he is relating to it. Then we slapshots. The gam, and also there's another aspect that tells us that this is be slapshots. Shebeshos zonik as heaven, that at the moment when he actually throws the stone, ein yochel las is dover acher. He is not capable of doing anything else. In other words, this identifies him completely with this action. He cannot do it inadvertently. He cannot do it together with other things. the word dziriko, the throw is not merely, as we discussed already, not merely disturbing the rock from its place, moving the rock from its place, which can occur without intent, even. A person is walking, and unintentionally he hits a rock, and the rock moves. This is not called zriko. Zriko means that he is throwing something with an aim, with a target. And that does not happen by itself.
When you say aim or target, means intention
also? Yeah. Him. And therefore he has to focus on what he's doing. He cannot do anything else at the same time. So this is the slapshus from the side of the actor. V'chein, and similarly, the effect on the object that is being thrown, who bendera his lapshus boy. This peulo affects him in his lapshus manner, meaning that it actually, as I said before, embraces the rock. It does not happen superficially. Shaharei, since that, poil be his chachos. This throw affects in the rock that his chachos something novel, completely novel, that is not part of the makeup of the rock. Vehu, which is she-al-yedayzeh even lemailo, that the rock should fly upwards, hepech tivoi, which is contrary to its nature. So we're talking about from the perspective of the rock exclusively. The hand, we already spoke about the person that he is aiming, doing something specific, is mislapsus. But the rock itself, the rock has a physical teva, nature, and when it's being thrown upwards, this is breaking away from its teva. The teva, however, for the nature of the rock is leirid lamato, is to descend downwards. Ubigdei lifel his chashus, and in order to affect a novel aspect in the rock that does not exist in the rock initially, because in its nature is to go down, to affect it something this chashus, something novel. Yefsheli is berach v'meila. Excuse me, that cannot be berach v'meila in automatic and inadvertent manner. Kiim, the only way it can be affected is bislapshus davko, is only when it is focused onto the rock and given the rock this novel activity, that it should fly upwards. Here again, as in the first half of it, the rock moving aimlessly is not called tzirika. Zriko means that the rock is going in a certain direction to affect something. And the rock should affect something up in the air is something completely contrary to its nature, because its nature is to go down. Therefore, this is an effect of his conscience in the rock. Okay, so this is the presentation of the Moshe. I know the Moshe is still a little bit elusive, the significance of it and so forth, but as we're going to go into the Nimshel, then it becomes much more clear as to what all of these things are alluding to. Okay, so first, the difficult part here that is a little bit not that obvious is the hislapshus principle. Like I said before, if you're learning something, there has to be hislapshus. You can learn, you can read the words entirely superficially, not being personally involved in what you're reading. That does not constitute learning. Because there you're reading the physical words as they are written on the page. But the words do not mean the physical presence. The words represent a seichel that they carry. And in order to identify with the seichel, you have to be mislabish in these words and to identify, to see what these words are revealing to you. This is hislapshus. Let us try and just physically identify the principle of hislapshus. When you put a garment on, you put a jacket on, you put your arm into the jacket, the arm of the jacket and so forth. You can put your hand through the arm of the jacket all kinds of different ways. Inside out, upside down. But in order to put a jacket, in order to do it right, you have to be mislabish. You have to identify how is a jacket supposed to fit on your body. Not just the arm. The whole jacket has to identify how it relates to your body. And then you put the arm through. This is your hislapshus. First you identify what you're trying to accomplish. Then you start doing the steps that bring it about. So hislapshus alludes to a complete relationship, not just for a specific act. Which, well, as I said, Nizrak, Zoyrek, the person is completely involved in this union. Not just his hand, but the whole person is involved in this. And so too is the rock that is being identified with a different phenomenon than what its natural state is. The aderach zeh, now we can continue. The aderach zeh. Well, a similar way, who lamailo, this we can see lamailo. In a higher sphere. Hahefresh, the difference, ben ilo v'yolo liyesh meyayi. Ilo v'yolo liyesh meyayi are two, you can say, methods, but two levels of divine revelation that is instrumental in the creation. what is the basis for ilu ve'olu? So again, going back to the throw of the rock, the koyach hazriko that's in the hand is of much broader nature than the throw of this particular rock. It's a total ability to act in a certain way and to accomplish something. Then when we are focusing this koyach onto a specific act, we are taking a certain aspect of this koyach, a very narrow aspect of this koyach, and we are imbuing it into this act of throwing, and that's when it's thrown. This is the idea of ilu ve'olu. Ilu means the cause, and olu is the effect. Ilu is much broader than what comes out in the olu. When a person throws a rock, we don't say he has the ability to throw this rock. He doesn't have that ability. He has the ability to create the throw. Is in a much higher level than the throw. Certainly than the specific throw. And this is ilu ve'olu. So I mentioned that there are two ways the way things occur coming down from above. One is the method of ilu ve'olu, and one is the method of yesh me'ayin. The ilu ve'olu, where in the case of ilu ve'olu, yesh oifan, there is a manner, there's a certain situation where we could say that from the ilos spreading forth and expressing itself the olu comes from derech me'ayin as a result of the fact that the ilo expresses itself. Mispashtus. The olul comes with derech me'ayin. The idea of hispashtus hayilo the word hispashtus means spreading forth. Now, if it spreads forth in an area I have to resort to a muscle. We have a barren field, plain in the wilderness, in the desert. No one walks in the desert and considers where is he going to put his house up. Doesn't see it from that angle at all. Nothing in this observation alludes, oh, the house would be here. But when a person walks in an inhabited area and he has a certain plot of land, then Yes, indeed, looking at this land, he sees its full development. Although it's not developed yet. But his pashtos ha'yilo, in other words, when he applies his sense of seichel, his sense of reality, now in full revelation in this environment, in this land, then he begins to identify with things, with objects, with houses, with streets, and so forth. This is that his pashas are ila. His pashas means that the ila finds a place where it can spread it, express itself. A person needs a home to live in. This is a natural thing. This is what a person is. But this is very vague and totally unidentified. What is it? What is required to make it a dwelling? What are prerequisites for this and so forth? This is in the human being that he has to have a place. But when this is applied to a specific area, the area draws from the source how this should be applied over here. So his pashtos ha'yila means the yila is mispashet within a certain environment. Not mispashet into nothingness. So mispashet ha'yila bo b'derech mamela, bo ha'ol b'derech mamela. Then the all surfaces b'derech mamela. Automatically, because the olo is initially contained within the ilo, not an identifiable way, but it's there. So when this is mispashit, and this is being recognized from the perspective of this situation, then it surfaces. So the olul comes b'derech memele, so to speak. It's revealed b'derech memele from the ila. When if the ila is mispashit again means it identifies itself with a certain situation. Okmoi. Okmoy, as in the case where it says hi chokhmaso, hi chokhmaso, this chokh, hi chokhmaso is pashtas, spreads forth the apik mino bino, and when it chokham is pashit apik mino bino, Bino comes forth from it. So Chochma and Bino live very, very minimally, but they're familiar with the principles. Let us go back to our motion of this dwelling and the area, this plot of land and so forth. The reason that a plot of land means something different to a person than a wilderness is that in his in his initial true makeup, in his chokhmah, he recognizes that there is such thing as a dwelling before anything materializes. In his chokhmah is identified the true meaning of a person's being in the world. And the true meaning of a person being in the world means to be in the world as a human being, representative of what he is, what he stands for. At that stage, at that point, there is nothing yet clearly identified, but the inyan, the principle, the sense of reality is there in the chokhmah. This is what he says. This chokhmah. let us take it back a little bit, then we'll understand the chokhmah. Above chokhmah there is rotzen and oinek. To take it very, very simply, oineg means delight. Rotzen means, he says, that he's fully accommodated. This oineg, the light element, says that there is a significance of the human being being in the world, of the human being's presence. This significance of his presence is in the most subtle and supreme manner identified in Oinak. Where would the human being be comfortable? Where would the human being find himself and experience the significance of his life? This is not Oinek. A human being has that level of Oinek. What is the full meaning? What is the meaning of my presence? It's not chokhmah, but he identifies it. But there is such an entity that if he should encounter and experience this would give him this oina, because he found himself. He's found his place. This is not pleasant, as we always translate. This is not pleasant from an experience. He found himself. This is Einik. And along with that, we say, there's a Rotzen, I don't want to go further than this, but it's obvious, because we talk about the totality of the human presence. Because human presence is not a presence of the wilderness, of the animal. That is not significant. Human presence is significant from the get-go. And when he identifies with this significance and it comes to full expression, then he has oinek, then he found himself. This oinek element is entirely an internal neshamah inyan. The neshamah knows that there is a meaning to his presence here. It's a neshamah knowledge. Not the knowledge in the so to speak in the offices of the world. When this neshamah
in the what of the world?
In the designs and activities of the world. When this neshamah element comes into the world to be identified as a reality, which is called Chochmah. So Chochmah sees things from a neshamah perspective, but it's seeing things from a neshamah perspective. It's not the neshamah the way it is in the neshamah per se. That's only. Chochmah has this phenomenal insight and sensitivity that Chochmah sees, looking at the neshamah, there is significance to this presence. It's not a personal thing, he actually sees it. The significance of this presence. So then the Zohar says, this Chochmah is very, it is a very high level because it identifies with the Neshama element, with the Oynek element. It sees things the way it is in the Neshama. Not the way it is in the world. But nonetheless, he sees it. Because he sees it, in other words, he already identified this as a reality in an arena outside of the reality of the neshama oinek. But this is mispashit. When this is mispashit and it finds place in the world, is apikas apik me bina, then bina will surface. Bina means that you begin to identify, yes, the significance of human presence, but how do you act upon it? What do you do as a result of this? This is bina. And this is all one continuous flow from oineg and rotzen to chochmah and then to bina. This is meaning for ill of all. We have to understand, if one has a bina, he doesn't have chokhmah, he has nothing. He has like the words without the content, without the meaning of the words. Similarly, if one would have chokhmah, but he doesn't have the oinag, the shoma element in it, it's also barren. You cannot teach Chochmah. You have to have a human neshamah.